I might have an international audience and they may not understand what hurling was, so I just put together a 1 minute video. It's just a quick 1 minute video as to what hurling actually may be, if you hadn't heard about it before. It's been described as a standalone to be considered the most skillful sport in the world. The movements required in tight spaces, even on a pitch 145 metres long and 88 metres wide, are sharp and concise. The feeling of a ball moving 100 miles per hour with a single touch of the hurler hand and moved on for a pass or a score in the blink of an eye is unrivaled in any other sport. Ed, I don't know if you remember writing that, but Ed, you wrote that in the Irish Examiner back in 2017, so I decided to steal it. So what it also is what it ultimately is, really, it's an amateur sport as well. So it's the most skillful sport in the world, but it's also an amateur sport. Typically in a training session, you might have a warm-up of 15 minutes, conditioning work of 20 minutes, skills and drills of 40 minutes, and you might have those intertwined. So you might have 20 minutes of conditioning work, and you might have 40 minutes of skills and drills at the start. And you'd have a cool down typically of 5 minutes. If you did that up on a chart, basically the way it would work is that roughly, and again, it's not the same for everybody, but roughly about 25% of it is conditioning work. So when I came into hurling, that's pretty much what I was expected to do. A lot of the conditioning work was going to be obviously on my end and what I wanted to do. And the rest of it then, as I said, cool down, warm up, and then skills and drills. As famous Fern Gambetta would say, drills do not always equal skills. But that's the way a typical session would be. And a typical session would might be anywhere from 2 to 3 times a week. Just to reiterate, what I would do normally in conditioning is probably what is typically expected of a conditioning coach is your mass training, your high intensity interval training, basically time at VO2 max. So any type of HIIT training. And at the time, what I thought was great about those things was that order always beat chaos. So I could obviously put in sets and reps. I could obviously dictate the time constraints on it, whether it was going to be 15 on, 15 off, 30 on, 30 off, the distance, the rest ultimately between sets as well as reps. And I just thought everything was nice and neat. Unfortunately from that then, obviously you're going to spend about an hour a week actually doing conditioning. So 60 minutes of your three sessions is going to be taken up by typically running. And if you're going to play the most skillful game in the world, I think you should be doing as much of that game as possible. So I went down basically and looked at papers on implementing small-sided games. Now, a lot of people do implement small-sided games for conditioning reasons, and that's, it can be taken in kind of different ways, and I'm not going to get into maybe unless people want to talk about the conditioning aspect of it. But what I wanted, obviously, was a formation that basically, if we play games, we're going to improve conditioning. And this particular paper by Shane Malone, basically put up in the final thing that basically, look, SSG with appropriate rules and pitch dimensions can be effective at enhancing aerobic and anaerobic capacities in hurling players. So we know then that the game itself can actually help with conditioning. We don't have to do these isolated running drills. They're good, they're tools in a toolbox, but we don't have to consign ourselves to just doing loads of running. Luckily, in hurling, particularly with Shane Malone, he's done a lot of work with the small-sided games. So I would talk to people and say, I'd go down a lot of rabbit holes then after that, and all the work that Shane and Kieran Collins have done as well, it's all out there. A lot of it, as I said, is based around conditioning. But for me, it was looking at that and saying, okay, I can implement games and that's going to improve conditioning of players. And that's basically what I wanted to do. From there, then you can go further afield and you can look at soccer. Again, there's a lot of work with soccer about conditioning games, small-sided in particular. These two books I'd also recommend by Raymond Verhagen, you may or may not have heard of him. He's quite critical about certain things that high-profile coaches are doing at the moment in terms of injury risk. He thinks we should all be playing the game. And again, they're all tools in a toolbox. They're not something that I necessarily hang my hat on and say, this is the best thing to do, okay? And as well, Adam Owen's work within, again, soccer, looking at conditioning games. And Clement and Hillhass, and look, there's loads of things we can get into. But for me, it was just, okay, we can play the game now. Let's play the game more often. One of the things as well that stuck out for me was in this particular study that they looked at enjoyment. And I think when we're doing training sessions, you don't necessarily say they should be enjoyable. For me, I think it is important that the players or the athletes or whatever you want to call them are enjoying the sessions. And obviously, probably didn't need a study, but SSG promoted considerably higher physical enjoyment more than the infield training. So players who were actually expected to be doing some sort of conditioning, they prefer playing the game and using that as a conditioning method, rather than obviously doing loads of running. Then I suppose I had conversations personally with Ed and with Alan about implementing my games-based training approach and kind of copying and pasting a lot of things and looking at it and saying, okay, well, we're basically going to copy this paper, what they're doing in that paper, and put it, apply it in my training sessions. I don't think that necessarily was the best way to go. And obviously having conversations with Ed and Al about skill acquisition and how we could put more skill work into our games and more player-led sessions as opposed to me dictating what they should or shouldn't do. From these pictures here, you can obviously see these three environments here are coach-led. You put down the cones, you get players to run through them, you get them to do running drills, and obviously ladders are components in some people's training sessions as well. Whereas if we actually looked at a player-led session, so for example, if you got the players to lead the training session, what would they want to do? Obviously, they'll want some level of enjoyment in their training. I remember I used to play soccer. That was my sport growing up. And I made the regional team for soccer. And the coach there used to put us into teams. And then when all the parents were gone, once he put us into teams and we started playing the game, he'd leave. He'd leave for about 45 minutes to go grab a cup of tea. And we'd just play the game for 45 minutes. And then he'd come back later before the parents got back. And say, oh yeah, we were training for 60 minutes and the lads were very good. And at the time we all thought he was lazy, which he probably was, but I think there was huge benefits of us just playing the game for 60 minutes as opposed to having this organized drill where you run from one cone to the other and et cetera, and all this kind of stuff that a lot of time is unfortunately just ticking boxes. From there, I looked into obviously small-sided games approach with regards to skill acquisition, a lot of Keith David's work here. And the different constraints you can bring in order to improve skill. And then started implementing that. And obviously my thinking then went from order being positive and saying, actually, do you know what? Chaos is probably a much better approach and we shouldn't really be looking for all these linear patterns and again, making the drills look nice in practice, but maybe the players aren't getting the maximum learning out of it really. So from there, we just said, okay, well, we got to bring in some task constraints. And we looked at Newell's work and how he looked at individual constraints and environmental constraints. And of course, task constraints and where individual would be primarily, obviously, the individual themselves with regards strength, fitness, age, height, et cetera, environmental. I have used environmental constraints before, particularly for fitness testing, submax fitness testing, sprint testing. Environmental would be obviously weather and surface as well. So when we're doing, for argument's sake, in one of my teams, they would have had access to 4G. So we'd have always sprinted on the 4G because I knew that if we sprint on 1 week and then change it and sprint on a different surface, depending on the weather, the surface will change. Whereas if you're consistently sprinting on the same surface, you're probably going to get a better effect out of it. And it's the same with the fitness test. We try and always do the fitness test on the same surface, because if you're doing a fitness test in January, December in the mud, and then you decide to do another fitness test in April, May, June, the outcome could be a lot different just because of what the players are running on top of. Okay, so that would be one with the environmental. But just for today, I was going to talk about the task constraints and say, okay, well, in that paper previously, manipulating task constraints allows players to explore and exploit self-organizing tendencies, which they can harness during training, developing their adaptive decision-making capacities, improving competitive performance. So obviously we want to put in scenarios that will get players learning more. I like this particular sentence as well from Mladen Jovanovic's book on the HIT manual. The goal is to make athletes adaptable, not adapted. So I like it because we want these outcomes that maybe when we do, let's say if somebody comes up with a drill that it looks great, it's very linear. It looks like it's everybody's enjoying it because it's not that difficult. And if you basically threw in some chaos instead, what would happen? And that can happen on any given day, obviously, because trying to manipulate the exact same scenario in a game is very difficult to do. And it's a lot easier to do if you've got four cones set out and you do a typical passing drill or shooting drill. So from there, I would like just to give examples on my end as to what I've done with teams and how I've basically changed constraints. Again, with conversations with Ed and Al, a couple of obvious ones would be the goal size. So you could make the goal obviously small, medium, or large. I've mixed it up as well. So we've had maybe small on one end, large on the other. Once we change games and obviously, or change half, sorry, then obviously both teams are playing into different goals. We've tried to manipulate the distance as to where lads can shoot from. So sometimes we would have put in, you can only shoot from 45 meters out or 65 meters out. We would have brought smaller goals forward from the main goals and said, okay, you can score goals in the small goals, but you can only shoot for points on the big goals and little things like that. Again, it's down, I think, a lot down to imagination and just people trying to, again, just manipulate the environment in order to make it more challenging to the athletes. Ball size or weight is another thing. Obviously, you can get different slitter sizes. Throwing in a different slitter size every so often obviously will lead to different outcomes as well. And again, you're just throwing in tennis balls. I've seen other coaches as well with tennis balls with the goalies. Obviously, with a tennis ball, it's going to travel faster than a slitter because a slitter can be quite heavy. So if you're using a tennis ball, then obviously the goalie has to react faster. So he's going to have to react faster to a save or something typical like that. And the same if they're doing passing drills or something like that. With the tennis balls, you're going to have to react faster in order to catch the ball and re-deliver it. Bibs, again, conversations with Al, we kind of dumped all the luminous bibs due to luminous bibs obviously being easier to make out. So if you've got, again, you'd be looking at obviously peripheral vision and things like that and saying, okay, well, if that team have luminous bibs and the other team don't, I can spot a fellow with a luminous bib a lot easier than I can spot somebody in a simple color like red or blue or something like that. So one year, yeah, with a team, we dumped all the luminous bibs after a quick conversation with Al about it. Relative square area, again, relative square area can be manipulated hugely. I think if you're looking just at soccer for small sided games, you can, with the relative square area, it's easier to get a soccer ball from one area of the pitch to the other. If it's a relative square, you can obviously pass it. You're going to kick it either way. If you're hurling and you make a really small area, there's probably going to be more hand passing than stick passing. So again, just going back to a lot of coaches are bringing on the small sided games approach. But in hurling, if you condense it too much, then your game becomes quite condensed as well. Because if players are in a small area and they're looking to get the ball quickly away because you might have three or four lads on top of you within 2 seconds based on the square area, a lot of the passing is just going to be hand passing. So I think looking at just soccer and saying applying the soccer model to the hurling model doesn't necessarily work because it misses out a lot of things. And the other thing, sorry, possession-based games, so you can decrease or increase the amount of passes allowed. That's an obvious one, of course. You can just say, okay, three passes and then you can shoot, or two passes and you can shoot, or one pass and shoot, etc. Again, that's down to the imagination. Again, it can be quite interesting because some players can obviously be quite smart. So if you're saying, oh, three passes and a score, if full forward is in a scoring position, but the opposition know that there's only been two passes made, your man hasn't got a license to shoot because they'll step off. And I've seen that happen as well. But again, you're just trying to get lads thinking a bit better. Position-specific games, that's another kind of thing I would talk about. People, when they're playing a small-sided games, they're not necessarily playing as backs, forwards, or midfielders. They're just playing a game that may be not reflective of their position. So if you, let's say, a full forward, and he's playing a game along with the full back or the half back or half forward, pick any position really, are they playing these games as midfielders? Midfielders obviously going to have to run more. And if you're a half back or half forward, you're probably you're going to have to make a bit more decisions in terms of that position in the field. If you're playing really condensed games, are they actually being exposed to that? So if I think even the backs v forwards model, I like having a backs v forwards model as opposed to having, let's say, 8v8 and just everybody in on each other, and again making it more position specific as opposed to just saying, okay, let's play 4v4 or play 2v2 or 6v6 and not necessarily playing for the position of each player. Hurley size, that's a big one that can be a tough challenge to get lads to change hurleys. Obviously everybody seems to have a personal relationship with their hurley, but it's another one you could add in, that you get a fellow who normally has a whatever it is, 34 or 36, to swap with a fellow who's a 30 or 32 and just see how lads react to that. Limiting option of passes, e.g. you can obviously say, look, hand pass only, stick pass only, etc. Again, there are other obvious ones. Certain player score being worth more than others. This is another kind of one I like to put in, that basically if, for argument's sake, you have your star full forward and everyone knows that he's going to be targeted, or if you your star half forward, and you say, look, address both teams and say one AV is not going to get any points for scoring and one of the others are going to get 2 points if they score. So figure that out and just send them out and basically just let them figure out which forward gets 2 points for his score. And then obviously it's up to that team to get more ball to that forward. It's a nice one to do. Again, you can address both teams without actually telling either team what you have in your head as opposed to how to get through. Not carrying over scores from games, e.g. 4v4 minutes. Again, that's something small, but I like putting it in. I like the idea of, like, let's say if you're playing two games and in both games the lads have been absolutely destroyed. I like to say, look, it doesn't matter what happened in the first or second game. You basically got to win games. So instead of carrying points and goals over to other games, you would just say, look, you would have a situation where if the first team lost by 10 points, they still get a clean slate every time. It helps maintain intensity as well, because I found that, again, a variable might be the scoreline that players might decide, okay, I'm not going to try too hard because we're already 10 points down, so what's the point? Switching positions of players, swapping forwards and backs, etc., and things like that. Again, another easier one to do. Time constraints, allocating amount of time to achieve tasks. So if you can obviously create scenarios where you're having, look, you're basically going to have a situation where you're 6 points down. You've got 5 minutes to get back. And just, again, throwing in the ball and saying, right, let's go. You know, give them a certain amount of time to get there. Again, just exposing things that may or may not happen during games as opposed to just having everything on autopilot. This paper is probably the final paper we talk about, really. It's a good paper. It was done last year. It outlines understanding how athletes learn and integrate in skill training concepts, theory and practice from an ecological perspective. I like it. It's kind of a, I don't want to say it's an easier to understand version of Skill Act that a lot of coaches can apply easy enough. It comes out with 5 guided training principles. The idea that the training design is the main stimulus for athlete learning. So what they're suggesting even in this paper is that the athletes are actually involved in the training process. And how often does that happen, that you might talk to your players and say, what do you think you need to work on? As opposed to a coach deciding, I know what he needs to work on, and just putting in a drill based on something that may or may not be occurring on the pitch. Again, having lads involved, encouraging the players to take the warm-ups, things like that. Just again, just creating that atmosphere where the players feel involved in the sessions as opposed to dictated to. I like the idea as well in this particular paper where they talk about the coach as being the moderator, and he's the facilitator and the moderator. He's not the dictator. He's not the fellow who decides everything. And basically you want the athlete to be in a learning environment, and are they being challenged every time they come to training? Train the way you play. It's their second training, guide the training principle. this will be probably obvious enough, but if you're looking at a lot of, again, the small side of games approach with a lot of coaches bring in, does it look like the way they want to the team to play? If you want to play a direct style of hurling, or if you want lads to, let's say your halfbacks to hit your full forwards, if you're constantly playing small sided games, is that going to happen? You know, are you exposing athletes to that, those scenarios? More often than not, I don't think people are. And because they think, oh, well, why don't we just all play the game? I think you can manipulate things, obviously, to represent what's going to happen in that game by, let's say, playing backs v forwards. Backs v forwards, I would have put into training, would be basically we'd backs v forwards, 8v8 in about two thirds of the pitch. The goalie is on the opposite goal and he's hitting into the halfbacks or half forward line. Again, just trying to manipulate those positions, getting lads used to the players they have to play with, getting the cornerback used to the fullback, as opposed to, again, just putting in 4v4 games or 5v5 games that just don't have any context with them, unfortunately. Repetition without repetition in training, that's obvious enough. But again, people put in cone-to-cone drills basically because it looks good. There's no dropping of the ball. There's no ultimate challenge. You go from one cone to another and you might hand pass the ball directly to the other player as he's coming against you. It would probably never, ever happen in the game, but it looks good. So you don't want that kind of situation where you want to be constantly challenged so that every rep may not be the same, but the player is thinking every time he has to do the drill. And that's ultimately what you want the athlete to be switched on. Again, encouraging exploration of movement, variability in training. Again, you want to put in challenges, you want to put in constraints in order to keep people guessing. The final one then, athletes are the problem solvers. A pretty obvious one, but most of the time coaches will tell the athlete what they should or shouldn't be doing. That's not necessarily helping the athlete to learn, I would suggest. It's basically if the athlete drops the ball, the first person to know who dropped the ball is the athlete himself. There's no need for a coach to tell him where he should be putting the ball and why he shouldn't be doing what he's doing. So again, the training should be exposing the athlete to an environment that allows them to do the problem solving as opposed to somebody telling them what they probably already know. That's pretty much it. I'm not sure what the time is, I'm afraid. I'm sorry about that.
You're good.
Am I good at?
You are good.
Oh, I'm spot on.
Thanks for that, Steve.
It went as rehearsed, so.
So if you want to unshare your screen, Steve, what we'll do is we'll jump to questions. And I think, Phil, there's a question from you in the chat there.
There is, yeah. Sorry, I said I'd take advantage. There's one question for me in the chat, and there's about seven questions for me on my spreadsheet beside here. So we don't want for me to be dominating the questions and answers. I'm quite happy to do so, but we'll try and get some more voices coming in. So if you have questions, by all means, please just drop them into the chat and we'll call as we go along. The question that I had is a really interesting one for me, because this was great, exactly what we wanted, lots of practical examples of the kind of things that you might manipulate. And I'm really interested in the relationship or the dynamics between yourself looking at the athletic development of the players and the coach who's looking maybe more at the, maybe it's the skill development, maybe it's some broader team play that they're interested in. And ultimately, you're working as a team, as a coaching team together to achieve the same aims. I'm interested in how you make sure that the activities that you run in the session are aligned so that you're getting what you need from a conditioning side of things, the coach is getting what they need. How do you arrive at a shared understanding of this is what we're going to do and this is how it's going to achieve both our goals?
Yes, that's a good question, Phil. I suppose I'm lucky in that at the level I'm at now, obviously with Cork, we've access to the technology that allows us to look at those things, the GPS, the heart rate monitors, the video analysis, things like that. That wasn't obviously always the way. When I was with the clubs, I would be big into the heart rate monitoring. I would obviously been used that a lot as part of it. I suppose just that conversation, really, though, if you don't have access to any of those things, it's just that conversation with the coaches and this idea that maybe, well, they're not being run into the ground, so why are you here, you know? And it's like I had conversations with coaches in the past who told me I'm the conditioning coach, I'm not the hurling coach, and to basically mind my own business and you have your 20 minutes and do something with that. And I just think that that's probably a challenge. I've had plenty of them, I won't lie. It's hard, as strange as it is, trying to tell a hurling coach that I think we should be doing more hurling does not go down as well as you'd think. So it's all of that conversation about, look, we can manipulate, if we want more sprint meters, obviously we can bring up more square area. If we want more X cells, D cells, we can bring down square area. If we want more, again, that representative game that I like is that back three forwards kind of situation where you just have, again, I managed to get GPS on the lads for as a tester just to see where we hit metrics that I wanted to hit. So I suppose it's really a conversation with the players as well, though. You know, like if a fella normally doesn't feel like he's ready to play, or if he doesn't look like he's doing well in a position he was asked to do, particular, like let's say if he switched from midfield to halfback or wherever he's been switched to, is he prepared? Does he think physically for that? It's just that conversation. I think it was easier definitely when we did loads of the repeat sprints and things like that, because you can kind of tick boxes and look at the research and say, well, I know 15 on, 15 off, mass, IFT. I know all those things will give me a certain adaptation. But what I was finding is that generally in hurling, most of the session is high intense. Hurling coaches like doing high intense work. And I think trying to, you can't just keep doing an hour and 20 of high intense work. So I said, look, I think we should be playing more of the game, and then at least we're still doing the high intensity work, but I'm just backing off a bit and saying, okay, well, what way do you want him to play? Okay, he's got to be a sprinter, so I'll look at the conditioning aspect of that and say, okay, we got to be working on sprints for this individual and things like that. I hope that answers the question, Phil. It's just I'm lucky that I have access to the technology they do now, but that wasn't always the way, obviously.
That's a great answer. But I think it's not just the technology that you've access to, but also the people that you've access to. And yes, I think what I really liked about your answer was how, you know, the depth of knowledge that you've got, the variations of constraints that, you know, I can achieve this outcome in different ways. So you're able to facilitate that discussion with the coach is fantastic. And I also really liked you mentioning the players and their role of, you know, working in as part of this as well. So lots of really fantastic things there. We've got some questions coming through, so yeah. I'll park the rest of mine for later. Philip, you had your next question, so we'll go to you next if that's all right.
Hi, Steve.
Hi, Phil. How are you doing?
Good, how are you?
Good.
My question was around kind of more off the field work. So I was kind of saying, how does kind of the training in the weight room look like? Would you kind of look at it more as building kind of general athletic capacity, or would you still use a lot of the kind of principles that you spoke about in your presentation, like maybe using variability and rep without rep, or would it be mainly kind of just a more linear in the weight room?
Yeah, that's a good question, Phil. Generally, when you talk to most team sport athletes, they think they're advanced lifters. And unfortunately, that's not the case. More often than not, the basics have been skipped at some stage or another, and they've gone straight into the complex stuff. I'm lucky again. I've in the past 3 or 4 years, I've been using VBT. I like a lot of our work is submax testing. So like we're doing submax testing in the weight room, and we're doing submax testing on the field. Just because we've access to that technology. If I think we were in the gym, I think a lot of it is looking at the particular individual and basically coming back to basics and saying, look, the idea that if we're doing, let's say, a periodization plan, for me anyway, it's like asking somebody, okay, we're going to do a fitness test today, and that fitness test is going to dictate our next 6 weeks. But just because you did that fitness test on that particular day, that particular time, those particular conditions, doesn't mean that that's where that particular individual's fitness is at, and it doesn't mean it's not going to change, because we're obviously constantly changing. It's the same with the weight room. So in the weight room, before I had the VBT, we used the reps in reserve, but it's mainly linear. It's mainly linear periodization, and it's nothing complex. We're mainly looking at basic lifts. It's if we were doing, let's say, a heavy week on the legs, we're doing probably less leg work in the gym that week. And I don't know, it as I said, most team sport athletes think they need to do some sort of complex programming and 10 by 10 and 5x5 and all the rest of it. And it'll probably still get them there wherever they need to go. My philosophy would normally be, what's the least amount that we need to do in order to get better? Because doing the most is obviously the easiest thing to do. Everybody can do the most amount and then hopefully people will get better. But I'd probably be more looking along those lines. I hope I answered that question, Philip, did I?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I suppose.
You can elaborate there, bud, whatever you want.
Like, by the variability and stuff, I meant in the weight room, like kind of maybe using maybe different weights, different equipment, maybe even some of the stuff, like if you've seen any of the stuff, maybe like Franz Bosch, like the kind of water and stuff like that.
I think there's a place for it, but they're all like tools in a toolbox, you know. Like, let's say if you have an individual and he's not strong at squatting and not strong at benching, I'm not, like, the priority for me isn't going to be bringing in loads of variability for him. The priority is going to be, okay, well, like, you can bring in the variability and you can have that, those options, of course. But I think, like, there's enough variability happening on the pitch in a lot of ways, like, especially at the moment, like, with the weather conditions, obviously, in Ireland, you don't know what kind of surface you're going to be playing on in 2 weeks. So, like, there's a lot of that happening anyway. And that's the other problem, I suppose, I have with the cone-to-cone idea, that it's a pre-planned thing. You've already pre-planned to go from this cone to this cone, and then out in the pitch, it's chaos, like, you don't have that pre-planning luxury. So I think we like to bring out in chaos as much as possible. But I think with regards to weight room, most of the time when I'm dealing with athletes, they're not as advanced as they think they are, and we'll probably just regress then based off of that.
All right, thank you.
All right, buddy.
That's really nice. Nice user questions. Thanks, Philip. We're going back to the planning theme. I'm going to call on Ross next to do a couple of questions. Ross followed by Mark, just asking about questions. Over to you, Ross.
Well, Steve, how are you?
Hey, Ross. How are you doing?
Good. My question, Steve, was just in terms of, obviously, everybody's context is different, but in your context, what does the design of those games look like? Is it still that you take that block of work and you have a design with your certain constraints and timing in mind, or are you kind of handing over ownership to the skills coach and then kind of probing and prodding with different ideas of constraints and timing based on what you're seeing in your GPS and heart rate and from your own coach's eye, or what does that process look like?
Yeah, it's been different. It's been different with different teams. One particular team, we'd all be having chats beforehand, and then we might have a discussion about, okay, well, what do you want out of today's session, and what do you want, and then more often than not, I found myself stepping back more than I am stepping forward. So as I said, there's been conflicts with coaches where the coach is like, Steve, you're conditioning, you just do the running and don't mind about this stuff, I'll worry about that. But again, I have that liberty of having that technology available to me. So if we're missing certain things that I want from that session that day, I can have those maybe 10 minutes or 15 minutes at the end of sessions to do those kind of top ups or things like that. But if I'm asked, obviously, for any sort of input, then I'll obviously share that. But it's been different with different teams. It depends completely on the coach, if I'm honest, Ross. If the coach wants to be in charge of all the drills and things like that, I'll obviously share my opinion. But for the most part, at the very start of my career, I found myself being more and more involved. And now at this stage, I'm less and less involved. I'm kind of saying, no, that's a good drill, we'll go with that. We might have a discussion about how long it should last for and how much, maybe the rest period isn't long enough. It should be longer if we want higher intensity and higher quality. But for the most part, I found myself stepping back more than forward. But again, I had that luxury with the technology I have. Cheers, boy.
That's great. Thanks, Stephen. So Mark, we'll go over to you next. And everybody else has questions, please just drop them in the chat.
Stephen, thanks so much for the talk.
Hey, Mark.
Good to see you, my man. My question, Stephen, is, when you're introducing games that might have you know, different constraints, varying constraints, and inevitably a game breaks down. I'm just wondering what your thoughts are, Stephen, just around actually embracing the fact that it breaks down, in kind of embracing the chaos that goes with that. Yeah. And rather than stepping in, allowing the players to kind of problem solve it and work it out for themselves. And I suppose just related to that, Stephen, how, if you've got three or four of these games going on at the same time, how you get a consistency of approach, maybe across the coaching team in that respect.
Yeah, it's tough. I mean, if we took, let's say, Shane Malone's work, and I'd be great buddies with Shane at this stage because I annoyed him enough after I saw all the papers that we've sat down for coffee multiple times at this stage. But it's that kind of copy and paste approach where you have to, I think a lot of the time they're going to be exposed to that in the match anyway. You know, like what's going to happen in the game? Like simple things like, are we going to be 10 minutes late? Is the warm-up going to be disrupted? And then that communication with the player and saying, look, this is our part of it. This is fine. You know, I think if something breaks down in training, you obviously have to figure out why it's broken down. But with regards to the games-based approach again, like there's this kind of, I think the fitness is almost a byproduct of whatever the game is going to be. And if the game breaks down, I'd rather it kind of broke down if what was happening was what I wanted to happen. Like if you were in a scenario where they're going, oh yeah, that was probably going to happen, but it's worth pushing on and just having that confidence. I suppose that's what it is, having confidence and saying, you know what, that's fine. Don't worry about it. It was probably going to happen. And we'll do it again and we recycle again because I think what's happening is important. And it's getting that buy-in from the player again. And just this idea that, you want it breaking down in a way, because if it's all fluid and stuff, maybe the game wasn't challenging enough, you know, that maybe if you felt, oh, if I put this in the game, this will happen. And if it doesn't happen, you're then going, oh, jeepers, maybe we're not getting the outcome we wanted. You know, I think it's so important to have communication with the player and acknowledge that all this fitness and all the rest of it is okay. Like it's almost a byproduct of the training. And I think initially I would have done loads of, I said, no, the fitness, like we'll do loads of running and then it'll be better for fitness. And then you'll say, okay, well, how does running expose us to what's going to happen in the middle of a championship game? And I think if it breaks down, I'm okay with that, as long as the players are okay with that. They're bought in. And again, that comes back to the whole training principles that I spoke about, that I think if the point is valid enough, I'd probably push it and just say, yeah, just keep going. That's fine. You know, as regards when games are going on at the same time, it doesn't often happen, if I'm honest, Nick. When I took Shane's work, it would happen. But now, more often than not, if there's, let's say, a game and then another game going on straight afterwards, I'd normally use, if you've half the squad resting, then the other half are in, you know, doing that game. So if you're doing a backs feet forwards approach, say, right, backs feet forwards, and you go, and then the other backs and forwards are resting, and then you say, right, other ones recycling. I'd rarely have the two games going together in that scenario.
Thanks, Stephen.
All right, buddy. Cheers, Mark.
That's lovely. There's some really nice ideas there. I'm just going to drop into the chat. There's a really nice paper from, it's a rugby union example, Jim McKay, about chaos and games that break down and the importance of embracing that breakdown and making sure that that's represented within your training as well. So I've just popped that in there. If anybody's interested in finding out more about that, if you haven't got access to that, just drop me an email and I can point in the direction of access to that. I'm going to pass over to Ed Colin because I can see him itching to go with a series of questions. So we'll let him loose. Over to you, Ed.
Thanks, Phil. And thanks, Stephen. Really, really great to hear just some of the concepts that you're applying, because I know a lot of people have difficulty applying them. But also great to see so many familiar names and faces on the call tonight too, which is great. My questions are more related to around, let's say, the players reaction to the work. We see quite a bit of it here in the department when we go through with our coaching science students or the coaching stream of other courses, let's say, when we start encouraging them towards more of an ecological approach or a constraints-led or games-based approach, let's say, most, if not all of them, have come through the very isolated drills-oriented type practice and finish with a game. And then when we encourage them towards, now, this is how we want you to experience it, and it's also how we would like you to coach it as you become coaches yourselves, there's pushback. You know, they struggle to get to it initially. Now, we're fortunate, we've got 12-week semesters to get to it with them over a few hours each week and so on. How have you found over the years, because I know we've had plenty of chats in all the different clubs you've been with and so on, how have you found that transition for players who may have had quite some success in the years gone by before they came across the Stephen Casey, where it was all very linear, all very organized and structured? And how have you experienced pushback from players when they don't get that hit?
The players push back less, it's more the coaches. Of like, I've never brought in as a hurling coach, obviously. I'm brought in as the S&C. And then when you sit down and you say, look, we're going to do loads of hurling, lads. And it's kind of like, no, you're not doing hurling. Why are we doing hurling? We're doing hurling here. And then maybe the drills don't represent what I think is actually hurling. And I'm there going, okay. And you have to have those tough conversations, and maybe it may not work out. But with the players, it's kind of like the players are kind of, I think they like to be challenged, and it's again going back to that enjoyment thing. Are they enjoying, like, and we've spoken about it before, like in the warm-up that you might do a drill that, and I haven't seen any paper on it yet about this kind of thing where you get the eye in, you know, we'll do this drill, Steve, because they'll get the eye in. And they're, what does that mean? And I'm there, it is something, there's obviously something in it, and people want to do those linear drills as part of a warm-up, especially if they're nervous and it's a big game or whatever, you'll put them in then. But it's some things you'll sacrifice. You'll say, okay, we are going to do that drill because you value it and you think you're going to get the eye in, and because you think that's why we're going to do it. And but then for the most part, like with everything else, I just think the players, in a lot of ways, it's an amateur sport, and very early days, like you would have done your typical 4-week or 6-week block that involved just loads of kind of running, whereas now I'm kind of gonna, we got it's the most skillful game in the world, we got to play it more, we've got to, from day one, we've got to hurl, and then we try and do that as quick as possible. You have to prepare tissues and stuff like that. You can't go straight into the game as such. But if the lads figure out, oh, we're going to do more hurling, you say, yeah, we're going to do more hurling. Of course we are. You know, you're not going to have that. If, as long, again, that conversation with the players, I've had that with players, where you say, do you think the conditioning is good? Do you think you're conditioned? So, yeah, I feel good. Or you might say, no, I think I need to do more running at the end. So, okay, well, look, because you think that, we are going to do a bit more running. But I think for the most part, it's never happened where I've talked to a player and said, I need to do more running at the end. It's never, ever happened. It's just literally, oh yeah, let's play the game. And even I was talking to Al yesterday or the day before about it, like, but when people come up with a drill and say, this is a hurling drill. And I'd say, do you know what, it'd be a great test and say, if you went in and said, okay, for all the boxes we're ticking regarding hurling, so how many boxes are we missing? You know, this is a drill. It's very linear. It's very, there's all this pre-planned direction. So it's ticking probably a small amount of boxes, but like hurling is unpredictable. It's exposure to speeds, exposure to jumping, landing, acceleration, deceleration. So they're going, okay, that drill, it's certainly not worth doing 15 minutes of that drill. But if the players enjoy it, maybe we'll do it for 5, maybe we'll do it for 7 minutes, but let's get back to the game as soon as possible. And again, that's just having an open discussion with both players and coaches about it.
Yeah, and can I ask then, as a result of that discussion, let's say, and again, I'll try and stay with the players, because I know we've had discussions over the past with the challenges with the coaches, let's say, but yeah. Oftentimes we would understand, or we were led to believe, that players in a more of a traditional approach, let's say, even from a fitness perspective, in your yeah. role, they just get the head down and they get it done. You know, we've got to get through this conditioning part and then we'll go back to do what the other stuff. But now that you're integrating it in, and there's a lot of the game in what they do with you, you know, over in your section, but it's not that much different. Do you get more engagement from them what I mean by that is, do they offer in ideas that we can do? Because I know in the more traditional way, we never hear from the players. They just go in, get the head down, and just get on with it.
Yeah.
Is there more engagement with players when we're actually integrating it into a game-based approach?
There is, it's kind of that scenario where the coach is the moderator and the facilitator. Like, so you'd hope that, let's say you're playing that game and then you brought him in, you say, right, you go over there for 5 minutes, discuss what's happening. Why is this happening? Why are we conceding scores on this end and missing scores on that end? And again, just have the players have that discussion with themselves. Like, I mean, I'm certainly not anti, like the lads are, we're still doing some sort of running with regards to what we're doing. So like, let's say for argument's sake, if the coaches decided to do that kind of small set of games approach, a lot of Excels, a lot of D-cells, and then I'll say, okay, well, look, there's no point in me doing loads of Excels, D-cells. So we'll do more maybe straight line running and things like that, just to top them up a bit. But I think once the players kind of get a bit more ownership of it, you'd hope to see it anyway, especially with leaders in the team, that they might just say, okay, well, look, we have to try and figure out what's going on. Like, as I said, like the scenario where you have maybe one player, he gets 2 points for his scores and the other player doesn't get any points. And the lads, like, it's just, again, that process where they're going, how is he getting scores? And this fella, and it's okay, we got to figure out how to get this fella into the game more. And again, rather than me jumping in or saying, look, this is obviously what's happening, figure that out, you just say nothing. Like, and again, that comes back to even an approach where, let's say, for argument's sake, we were doing a hit block, and I'd be almost torturing the players. Like, you tell them they do 6 runs and they have to do 12, you know, and you get that kind of going, well, you said 6. And I was there, I did, but we're not doing 6, we're doing more. Because again, even there's a great book out there, Endure, by Alex Hutchinson, about how we just have in our heads, like we pace ourselves, even though we tell ourselves we don't, we do. Once we know we 6 runs through, we'll pace ourselves for the 6. And the same in the game scenario, I think it's just, again, taking out those variables like the score, the opposition, and the time left on the clock, you know.
One final question before I go back to Phil. And you've mentioned a lot of the science, the evidence, and so on. And as an applied scientist myself, I love to see that because it guides my own work. Is there anything as a practitioner on the field with these people that you think we have not looked at enough yet? If you were to come into our department here, what would you, and we'd unlimited budget, what would you ask us to be? What would you ask us to research on your behalf as a practitioner on the ground?
Oh, there's a question in. Jeepers.
Or maybe, sorry, let's leave it to the end.
Let me think about it. I don't know. I think I was going to put up another slide. I was talking to Al about it, another slide, like, where I just think people are so comfortable now with, like, when they read a research paper, they just say, right, I'm now just going to copy exactly what this research paper. But like, I'd always say, like, a paper is more like a license, you know, like we all when we went out to learn how to drive a car, we were all told what to do. And then the minute we got our license, we just said, right, I know this now, I'm going to figure out myself. Whereas unfortunately, with an academic situation, you say, okay, well, this whatever drill you decide to do, whether it's, let's say, a 4x4. Yeah, because let's say 4x4 minutes on small-sided games. And that's pretty much what Shane's research is. And then I made the mistake of just copying and pasting that, saying, this works, so I'm going to copy it. Whereas really it was just a license. Say, small-sided games work. We just have to create more constraints for it. Like, and as opposed to what could we do for the research? I'm not sure. Just, again, not being completely... you just have to have an imagination, maybe that's what's lacking, imagination with people, and just saying, oh, you want me to think about this? Is it? Well, yeah, please, because you can't just copy and paste the whole way through, you know?
I can't wait to see what the ethics committee come back and say. Well, I'd like to research imagination strength and conditioning in sport. I'll keep you posted. Thanks. Back to you, Phil.
Thanks very much. I've just plugged something into the chat there, because I think one of the things you raised, which is really important, is the importance of, you know, connecting the research to your context. It can't just be copy and pasted. A really important one. That was a major feature in a really nice talk from Dennis Horton and Mark O'Sullivan in a previous webinar series. So others want to learn more about that. There's, again, a lovely applied example there. I'm going to go to Jordan in just a moment, but I just want to ask one other question, which just follows up on your conversation with Ed there. I'm really interested in educating players to be more skillful learners. And so I'm curious as to, you know, to what extent do players come in having an understanding about what effective practice looks like and what the more effective types of practice activities and designs are? And to what extent do you see yourself as having a role of educating players to recognize and engage in more effective practice?
Yeah, in hurling, and you'd have that conversation about maybe the wall alleys and things like that, you know, with players. And obviously, basically people want to go on the wall alleys to improve touch and getting their eye in and things like that. And I think it's that conversation again with the players, what does he or she value? And if they value it, I'll never say it's not good or it's not beneficial, but I might steer them in a different direction and say, well, we're doing these scenarios here, but let's bring in different scenarios and say, look, the wall alley is great. Again, I'm not dissing anything with the wall alley, but it's just that how many boxes are we taking and how many are we missing? And then try and involve the player and say, how many boxes do you think we're not taking here for your position and what you're going to be exposed to in championship and whatever happens. It's again just that relationship with the player. I think in a lot of scenarios, the players, maybe it's the culture, I'm not sure, but the coach tells the player, you know, the coach decides how to, in teams I've been involved with, the coach is basically telling the player what to do, and there's not a huge amount of involvement from the player. Like, again, that scenario where you say straight away to the player, you missed the shot, or the player will catch the ball in the middle of the pitch, and then the coaches will shout, pass the five, pass the four, and you don't want that scenario where you're literally telling every player what to do. You got to let them figure out for themselves. And again, just coming back to that relationship with players and saying, okay, if everyone said nothing on the line, don't, and I know it's hard of troopers to be there yourself and shouting at players and things like that. But if you have a situation where you say, okay, just let the player figure out himself or herself. And again, if a player firmly believes in something, it's the same approach I'd have to everyone, a coach or indifferent. Like, I wouldn't be necessarily saying, no, what you're doing is complete rubbish, stop doing it, like, because you can't have that relationship with somebody. You have to say, okay, well, that's good, but I'd also integrate this, wouldn't that be better? And they may or may not agree with you, I don't know. Hopefully more often than not, they agree.
What I really like there is, you know, the general point about how, you know, the skill acquisition knowledge is great, but it has to be built upon a sound relationship first, that foundation. A really nice answer. Jordan, kept you waiting. Sorry. Over to you.
Oh, yeah. Thanks very much, Stephen.
John, how we doing, bud?
Good, thanks. Thanks for the insights. It's been really good to just listen to your experiences in that. My question is sort of backtracking a bit. I think Mark brought it up initially around failures, or failures within games and whatever, small-sided games. Would you ever try to kind of periodize that? So at certain times of the years, you promote a higher failure rate, maybe to aim for greater learning, and then as you're coming into championship or whatever, that, you know, you're trying to promote a higher success rate. And if you do, what are the challenges either with players or with coaches in, you know, going with that, you know?
Yeah, it's a great question, bud. I mean, you've got to be careful. I think it depends on the environment that the player is in. You know, if it's, let's say, for argument's sake, a player, again, just their personalities and things like that, and getting to know the person and say, you know what, if I kind of, this is a bad session, how badly is he going to take it or she going to take it, and how long will this go on, and like, if I intentionally want them to fail, it's tricky, because let's say if you did it the week of championship, that'd be a terrible idea, obviously, because they're going, right, the conference is going to be gone. But I do plan around certain things, definitely. I don't necessarily plan about failure, but I might plan a fitness test and a strength test around a certain time of the year to say, do you know what, I know these are going to be good results and this will help with their confidence. So it's a great question, but it's a tricky one, because it's again, it's one for the imagination department there in MTU, maybe. But it's like, yeah, I've never done it. I honestly haven't done it, because if I think from a strength and conditioning point of view, let's say for argument's sake, I knew a fellow was going to fail on this particular weight on the bar. There's so many things going on in my head about, okay, if he fails and he failed in front of the whole team, what are the consequences of this? How long is he going to carry this, you know? Because I think Gerard Hegarty talked about it last year, where he'd failed in front of, I don't know, he had to lift a certain amount of weight in the gym, and he had to do it in front of everyone, and it really gave him a good lesson then, and he took the gym a bit seriously. So timing would be everything on that one, I'd say, Jordan. You'll have to do some research on it, but I'd be interested in the results.
Yeah, I'll have a look and look into it. No, thanks for that.
Cheers,
in terms of doing research, we've just heard that MTU has an unlimited budget. So, you know.
Well, it's going straight from there.
Let's go straight for there. We've got another question in from Alana. Alana, are you okay to jump on the mic and ask it yourself?
Yeah, I'm just wondering, I'm an athlete, I'm not a player like of GAA or anything, but should sports people, should we kind of leave it up to more professional people, people who know what they're doing in terms of skill acquisition and learning? And or should we actually kind of look at the papers ourselves and try to almost not do it ourselves, but get involved in some way? Sorry, I hope that makes sense.
No, I mean, look, as I said at the start of the presentation, I'm not claiming to be an expert in skill act at all. If it wasn't for Aid and Al, I'd know nothing about it. Have I learned a lot of them? Of course. I think do you need professionals involved? I would say yeah, because I would have come up with certain ideas with Al and Aid, and they would have said, no, that what you think is happening there, Steve, is not happening, and you need to rethink that. And I think it's just better to maybe involve the professionals from that side of things. I think obviously if you've read a paper and you've said, gee, but you know what, this could really benefit me, I can really relate to what's happening in this paper, and then obviously there's going to be benefit from there straight off. But for the most part, certainly if I was involved in a team and I was told I was going to be a hurling coach, the first fellow I'd call is probably Alan Dunton, and after that it'd be Aid, and I'd say, look, I need help with this. I'm not going to claim to know or be an expert in skill act, so for that reason they'd be the first people I'd call, you know. Does that make sense to them?
Yeah, it does. Thanks so much.
Yeah, no problem.
Do you mind if I just jump in there, because I know you've mentioned, but I the chats between that we've had, I do think it's important. Most of the chats we've had, you'd say the same, Steve. We say, well, we don't know.
Yeah.
But this is what we think, and this is what we've tried. And I think that's a key part of this, Alana, is that we don't know either, because it might have worked in one context before, but it's because it didn't work in another context that we do say, I don't know, it mightn't work here. So you gotta try and have a look and see and test it and try it. Like Stephen was saying himself, there's so many things that we still don't know. There's a lot of people who've got very rigid ways about how they view it. I suppose the more and more I do, the more I realize actually there's a lot of ways we can skin this, let's say. And I think that's probably why we have so many different chats amongst us and within Movement Skill Acquisition Ireland, is because we're all just kind of keen to try and figure out the next little bit, because maybe it worked elsewhere sometime for a while, but maybe it didn't even work elsewhere all the time, you know. So it's trying to figure out how it might work a little bit more in another context the next time.
Yeah, agreed.
That's a great question, Alana, and I've got a couple of responses. I might pop one in the chat as well, just to add up and try and pull a couple of resources together, because I think it's something I'm particularly interested in. So, really great question. Okay. We're going to go over to Sam next. Sam's got a question for you, Stephen. So, when you're ready.
Question or two, Steve. Apologies.
Hey, Sam, how are you doing?
Yeah, I suppose the first one, kind of what stood out from one of the first things that you were kind of touching on, just wondering how your interactions, communications, conversations with coaches has evolved over the years as your approach as a whole has evolved? Because I think, you know, for the most part, if we think about a lot of the traditional conditioning activities that we would do, particularly on pitch, they would be deemed much different to some of the activities that we could do that encapsulates a games-based approach. Have those conversations actually evolved, whether it's, you know, the inclusion is greater or just the content of the conversations as a whole, have they changed in any way?
Yes, that's a good question, Sam. Yeah, because initially when I came up with the idea of doing more games-based approach, I had no history, you know, and what I meant by that is, I suppose I'm lucky in that I've been involved with successful teams, so that helps. And if I hadn't been, nobody would be listening, do you know? And yeah. So when it went in first and said to a particular coach that I was involved with, I want to do more hurling, I want to do less running, and I want to do more hurling. And his response was, no, Steve, you're a conditioning coach, you do the running and we'll do the hurling. And then they're going, okay, that's not going to work, is it? Now, I've had, luckily at that stage, there was obviously, there wasn't just the one coach involved. So I managed to get other lads involved that were in that coaching setup, and they bought into us and said, yeah, I would do that, whatever you think, Steve. And it helps because you can go in and have that approach based on, again, your, it comes back to relationships with coaches. I think, like, if I talked to an individual who I've never met before and he sat down and said, can you get a question or can you become involved with this team? And I'd say, well, I don't know you. And what's your approach to training? And they'll say, well, we do this and we do that. And I'd say, okay, I don't, that's not the way I'd approach it. And then they'd say, oh, well then forget it. So I'd say, all right, forget it. Good luck, you know? And it's, whereas now you kind of have a conversation. If you can have a conversation with a coach and he's open to changing and you're also open to changing, because obviously you don't get your way all the time. You can fight battles and hopefully you win the war. But I think just my approach has changed, and I'm lucky in that there's been success. And then people think that maybe all the success was because you did that. And that's not necessarily true either, of course, because more often than not, maybe the success would have happened regardless. But yeah, my approach has changed. And hopefully, I'm going back to kind of Alana's question, I suppose, in a way, if you're working with a coach who's still the same coach after 3 months, 6 months, 9 months, you're probably working with the wrong coach, you know. You constantly have to change, and in order for you to change, the people you're working with have to change as well.
Easier said than done,
unfortunately. But but like, I'm not going to lie, I've had full-blown bad conversations, arguments with coaches in the past. It's unfortunately the way it happened. But never left the side. So despite the blowout and despite the arguments, we still luckily came to a mutual understanding. But unfortunately, maybe the first thing had to happen in order for the second one to happen.
If you don't mind, if I jump to something else again, I think that always stands out for me with conversations like this. I suppose given the specific context of the GAA and the athletes that we're talking about, particularly at that elite level, trying to strike that balance, obviously, between the athletic needs of the individuals, plus, I suppose, the stigma that comes with being at that high level and what others perceive needs to be done within the four walls of the gym or on the pitch or whichever it is. Combined with the fact that these individuals are already coming to you, having worked their 8 hours, being up at whatever, plus doing everything else that they need, how to strike that balance between what's actually needed to make sure that we're obviously not stressing them too much, but we're still dosing them to the point that they need. And just to tie back into what you kind of said earlier, where a lot of these athletes, they maybe aren't actually at the level that they think that they are at within the four walls of the gym. Is that actually something that maybe that we can actually capitalize upon, so that we know that we actually don't need to stress to the level that many might actually be thinking that is required?
Yeah, it's a good question. I mean, it's more often than not, I spend as much time working on the recovery as I do working on what happens on the pitch and addressing lads and saying, look, are you sleeping enough? Have you invested in a blackout blind? Do you know, these kind of things where lads will say, I bought the Oura Ring, I bought the Fitbit, I bought the Whoop. You know, they're going, okay, have you got a decent pillow? No, why would I need a decent pillow? You know, it's just that conversation. They're going, look, more often than not, when you're training with a team, if the training session is lasting an hour and a half or an hour 20 minutes, it's going to be a tough session. Do you know, unless there's a lot of standing room and a lot of talking, more often than not, it's going to be a tough session. So mainly my conversations with athletes then is, okay, we're going to recover as well as we train, because everybody trains hard. But when it comes to recovery, people just forget about it, saying, oh no, recovery will happen. And like, just again, educating them on sleep and nutrition and hydration and those stress levels as well. Like, I mean, a lot of athletes now carry the Whoop and they carry the Apple Watch, and there's constantly data being collected off them, and they don't understand what the data is. And they're saying, look, this is HRV, this is resting heart rate, these are why the numbers are saying what they're saying. And again, just, yeah, definitely when it's meant to be a tough session, it's going to be a tough session, and the lads know, okay, this is going to be a tough week. You know, be mentally prepared for that as well as physically prepared. But then at the same time, when I'm telling them it's going to be a light session, they know, they trust then that, okay, it's going to be a light session. It's not too bad, you know, because you're looking after them. But yeah, definitely there's the approach that we need to train harder. We're training hard 3 times a week. We need to train harder. They're going, probably not. There's so many other things we could hit in terms of physiologically that we could hit instead of just, again, doing more running or doing any sort of conditioning or something like that. More often than not, I'm telling them, look, lower intense stuff, like if we focus on cardiac output, on like just low rest, not low resting heart rates, but low working heart rates on our days off, and just increase our recovery, and then come back to me on Tuesday next and be ready to train hard again. That's probably the conversation I've had more often with athletes, and asking them to train harder. Sorry.
I am just going to take that slight break in conversation to jump in and say thank you very much, Steve, initially. I would like to also say that you definitely shifted too much credit away from yourself at countless points in that conversation. No. I'd also just like to very quickly flag with everybody the next webinar in our series. I think if you can see that, we have Ross Pinder and Georgia Askew from Paralympics Australia, who are going to be with us on the 28th of February at around 8:30. And other than that, thank you all for jumping on with us this evening. I apologize for any YouTube disruptions. We'll get that video up as soon as we can. And again, thank you very much to Steve and everybody who engaged in the Q&A this evening.